Assalamu alaikum. Friends, may Almighty's peace and blessings be upon all you, the viewers. I'm just sitting in front of Dr. Nejathullah Siqqidi sahab, one of the great scholars and expert in Islamic finance and banking of today's world, contemporary world. He is the Professor Emeritus of Aligarh Muslim University, as well as he is the recipient of the prestigious King Faisal Award for Islamic Studies, and then he has written several books and attended several conferences, international and national, and presented his papers and his thoughts. And I hope that we will discuss so many things on today's interaction.
Thank you, Mr. Abdur. It has been a nice association interacting with you for the last few years when we launched this scheme. As you know, the problem is we all prepare for the future, and whatever economic or business propositions we have, we know that future may not be what we expect it to be. There are risks involved. Now, there are two ways of facing these risks. One, which has been the essence of the conventional approach, is to shift it to one side only. And the other, for which we stand, is to participate in facing these risks. That is the essence of the situation which I wish to explain today.
What is the difference between this Islamic finance and banking and also the conventional finance and banking in terms of its...
As I told you, Mr. Abdur Raqeeb, the essential difference is, are we going to shift it to one party, or we are going to participate in a way which is felt to be fair and experienced to be fair. Now, if you shift it to one party, that has been the bane of the society since beginning. It affects the business, the user of the funds. He may lose, but he has to fulfill his obligations, not towards repayment, but towards increment, which is termed as interest. That seems and obviously is unfair. What we stand for is, let the results be shared. If the results are good, some profit goes to the user of the funds, some profit comes to the supplier of the funds. If the shares are bad, then the user of the fund does not compensate for the loss. He returns what is left, and the user, the supplier of the fund, bears the loss in capital. That is one round. There will be several rounds, and hopefully in coming rounds this deficiency will be removed.
Professor, do you think that is it practical? Because today everywhere, all over the world, in internationally, only interest-based things are there, and there is no option for some other thing there in this practical world.
There have been options being tried. There are options being tried at various places on a smaller scale. We cannot say that it has captured the scene, but we cannot ignore it. There are many places in the world, Muslim majority countries, non-Muslim countries, countries like Britain, countries like Singapore, where there are possibilities of two parties coming together, one party supplying the fund, the other party using the funds, and both sharing the results equitably in the manner I explained to you. Now, how to convince people? We refer back to the past history. Over thousands of years, the current conventional interest-based approach, which shifts all the risks to the user of the fund, has been making the poor poorer and diverting poor people's wealth towards rich people, making them richer. This has increased inequality, and as the publications over the last decade have shown, since the crisis of the financial system in 2007-2008, inequality breeds lot of problems. Ultimately, it threatens peace and destroys good relations between countries also. So it is all a matter of showing people what has been happening, and since it is experienced by people, I don't think it will be very difficult.
Apart from this risk sharing part of this alternative finance and banking, what are the other features, Dr. Siddiqui, about this new type of finance and banking?
You see, the other feature is that it is completely in sync, in harmony with the nature of life, not only in business and finance, but also in family relations, social relations. We tend to cooperate with one another. It's a form of cooperation rather than confrontation. Ultimately, shifting of risk results in confrontation. Poor of the country are pitted against the rich of the country. Poor countries pitted against the richer countries, and the world tends to be divided in two blocks. One block dominating, supplying funds and draining the resources of the recipients through interest charges and charges of interest on interest charges. This has been happening towards the last 100 years. There are famous studies, starting with the study of Thomas Piketty, which have recorded this, and all that is needed is to bring these to the notice of the people and give them hope about the alternative model which we are presenting.
Apart from this, people say that it has got definite domain of investment. For example, people say that it goes for ethical investment. What do you mean by ethical investment, Doctor?
You see, there have been calls for not investing in projects which destroy the environment, increase global warming, or encourage armament. You know, there are many countries in the world which thrive by producing arms and munitions which are used to destroy other people. So ethical investment tries to bypass any activity, not funding them, which is destructive of people, destructive of environment, destructive of the ecology.
Doctor, if you go for ethical investments or socially responsible investments, the profit will not be so much as the finance is for investment of finance is for profit. But if you go for the socially responsible and ethical type of investment, the profit won't be the same as in the conventional finance. How can you figure out?
This is a thesis yet to be proven. And even if the temporary figures, the figures about profits are larger, we have to take a longer view of life. What is the use of larger profits when ultimately destroys people, destroys peace, threatens good relations between people? So if you take a long view and take the survival of the planet Earth itself into consideration, you have to contend with a lower profit, which is more conducive to good living.
So apart from that, how do you call this type of alternative finance which you are talking about?
The essence is participation, cooperation. Since cooperative has been used for other activities in the large scale, I prefer personally to call it participatory finance. It catches the spirit. Some people add it interest free, but interest is only representing the shifting risk phenomena, and it is not necessarily describing the spirit of the new arrangement. So better name is participatory finance.
How to convince people because people are used to the conventional finance,
yes,
and banking?
You see, the convincing thing is always needing two types of activities. One is bring knowledge to people, more knowledge about what has been going on in the name of conventional finance, how it has been destroying people, increasing poverty, increasing inequality, threatening peace. The other is, whatever small scale or large scale experiments are being done in other parts of the country or in outside the country, in other areas, Southeast Asia or Gulf region or Britain, we need to inform people because that is not well known. So both things being needed, convincing arguments, logical arguments, historical arguments, and contemporary reality.
Doctor, the last question that I want to ask you is, India is a great country of 1.2 billion people, and majority of them are non-Muslims, and other community people are there. So in a plural society like India, how to talk to the people, in what terms, whether we have to call it Islamic finance and banking or some different name as you are talking about participatory banking, how to convince the people, both Muslims and other communities?
The essence of our religions has been compassion, good brotherly relations with other human beings. And conventional finance is obviously based on a very selfish view of wealth. Somebody who has wealth demands that its use must be given some privilege, and somebody who is using it and does not succeed because of no wrong done by him, but because of changes in situation, changes in weather, changes in world political situation, so being penalized by being asked to repay and pay the interest. So this type of inequity needs to be explained with historical evidence. People have gone on record how in India itself, our own country, over centuries, land ownership has passed from the cultivator to the lenders, money lenders. And not only they have grabbed land using the excuse of non-payment of debt, but also made people bonded labor for generations. A father who fails to pay his debt leaves his son in bond, not only to pay the debt, but also to serve the Mahajan, the lender. So all this is available in history. It needs being, and I don't think there is any particular religion involved in this issue. All religions stand for fair treatment, justice, compassion, and we need to obey in the name of this common essence of our religion, not in the name of Islam itself.
So if we in India, if you want to start something, which are the projects that you feel that Indian government and the people of India can get started and get benefited,
Doctor? Of course, government has a big role to play, but we cannot wait for government approval only. The laws as they are give us enough freedom to start cooperative banking, to start microfinance, and we are already, as you are aware, we have microfinance societies, and we are at the same time the government, which has been kind to declare that it wants to go in for inclusive banking, and it has recognized in the earlier days that one thing which is needed to include all people is to remove some people's objection. If they don't want to deal with interest, we can have arrangements at our banking institutions to open a window, allow them to deal with their savings in a manner that they get a return on the basis of fair distribution of results rather than on the basis of interest. So all the two fronts, cooperative ventures allowed by the law, and government, persuading the government to allow this to function side by side with other forms of banking, should continue.
The last question, Doctor, is the Sukuk, some people are telling that Sukuk will help India in its infrastructure development. What do you suggest?
As you know, the essence of Sukuk is that you start a project for which there is assured rent or some type of income, and then you go to people and say, you participate by supplying us funds, and we have a contract with the government or some other business corporation, and here is the possibility of return, we will share that return with you. So that is a type of ijara bonds, ijara sukuk. There is a lot of literature available on this, and I think India, which needs to invest heavily in infrastructure, will greatly help this. It makes it possible for people outside India to invest in India through Sukuk. Also, there are savings lying idle in India. If the rules are made to for people to mobilize these savings and then use them in India or outside India for infrastructure development or any business proposition through Sukuk, it will be a good idea.
Thank you, Dr. Siddiqui, for sparing your precious time and discussing the various aspects of alternative finance and banking, that is called the participative finance, as you are calling, and hope this our great country will do some experiment. Both the people of this country as well as the government will take some action, and this interest-free, participative and risk-sharing finance will come into our great country very soon. And as you say, that before the government is opening up all these things, cooperative type of finances, which is available in terms of microfinance and a small business type of things, can people really start taking into it. And I'm sure that what you have been talking to me will also inspire people and inform people that we can do a lot of things. So thank you very much. And then I just want to say to you that Dr. Nejathullah Siddiqui staff has written several books, presented many papers, and also attended several seminars, and his books are available in the Google, and as well as his phenomenal work, Interest-Free Banking, has been taken as a Bible for Islamic finance and banking throughout the world, and people are experimenting on this way he has been presenting. And so we also request you to go into our website, Indian Center for Islamic Finance website, www.icif.in. Thank you.